Hello there, televiewers. I hope you're having a great weekend. Well, thank you very much for joining us in this week's edition of The Diary. Now, it is not uncommon in Cameroon to find women running very successful businesses or holding titles in the upper ranks of management. And Cameroonian women are also taking on traditional or on jobs traditionally dominated by men. Yes, we have come a long way. However, the 21st century Cameroonian woman has to grapple with several challenges that are peculiar to her gender. On the eve of this year's edition of the International Day of the Woman, let's talk about some of these issues. Don't go away. Welcome back. If you're just joining us, you're watching The Diary on STV, and it's always a pleasure to be in your company. It's now time for you to meet my guest who will be joining me in discussing today's subject. You're not surprised. This week, women around the world are celebrating the International Day of the Woman. The day itself is tomorrow, the 8th of March. And today's theme is the realities of today's Cameroonian women. My guests are all women. You definitely understand why. Women talking about women, issues concerning women. Now, let me start with the person sitting closest to me. It's the first time you're seeing her on the show, and it's really a pleasure to have her. I've been trying to get her on the show for a while now. Her name is Maria Abanga. She's a barrister, she's an activist, and she's the founder of Hope for the Abused and Battered. It's actually a foundation that works to help women who have been battered, who have been abused, some of them raped. You should definitely follow on social media. You'll be shocked by some of the stories she's working on. Hello, Maria. It's good to have you on The Diary, finally.
Good afternoon, Mama. Because it's for women and about women, and I'm one of them. Happy to be here to talk. Sometimes it's tough talking about our issues, talking, but I think that we can also share what we ourselves are doing so it can inspire other women to through it all.
Exactly. That's the goal of today's show. Thank you so much for being with us. Sitting right next to Maria is someone you've had the habit of seeing on the show. Not only on this show, you have the habit of seeing her on TV too. Her name is Clarice Ndinge. She's a blogger. She's a TV personality. She's a businesswoman. She's an entrepreneur. There's so much that we can talk about, Clarice. Clarice, it's good to have you back. It's been a while.
It's good to be here again. You know, I'm so happy to be here. There's a lot we can talk about since we are talking about women and all of us are women.
Yeah.
It's always a pleasure to be on the show and to share and just to talk about what it is that's happening in our lives as women.
Right.
Yeah.
And now to the next guest. She is a first timer on the show, and I'm hoping she's going to have a great time. Temben Collect is her name. She's the assistant managing director of Jama Commodity Sales. I'm wondering though, Jama Commodity Sales, what do you deal in? What does your company deal in? By the way, good afternoon and welcome.
Good afternoon, Amanda. It's my pleasure to be here today. Hello, televiewers. I'm Temben Collect, as was just said by Amanda. I'm the assistant managing director of Jama Commodities. Mm-hmm. And Jama Commodities is a company that deals with export of cocoa and coffee.
Right.
And we have been into the sector for over 13 years today. So wow. We are hoping to be the leaders in the sector.
Thank you. I am imagining you get paid a lot of money. Import and export of cocoa. Anyways, we'll talk about that after the show. It's time for us to get into the heart of our subject, which is the realities of women in Cameroon. And I wanted to have women to talk about this because these are things that affect us as Cameroonian women. Now, the basics on the show, I always like to start with the basics. And my first question would be, let me start with you, Maria. Do you feel that as a Cameroonian woman, you're able to exploit your potentials to the fullest? You feel like the environment is enabling?
Enabling environment, not completely. So I create my own environment.
Okay.
But then you need to be able to do that. And that's something that I think many Cameroonian women are not able to do. Mm-hmm. Well, because, you know, it's easy to blame.
Yeah.
So when you blame, then you can just stay you in that situation. Mm. And then everybody will just be saying, well, sorry, it's difficult. That's true. The environment is not enabling.
Mm-hmm.
But I think we've come a not so long way, but we've come some way.
Yeah.
And the women have to push, and the women can bring the men along now. I think it should no more be about fighting, but frankly speaking, enabling, that's a word not so easy to use, honestly.
But would you say that it's easy to be a woman in Cameroon today, 2020?
Well, yeah, easier to be. Easier to be than even when I was growing up, seeing what my own mother and the other women went through. It's easier to be.
Okay.
I mean, we can continue complaining, that's true, but it's easier to be.
Right. Okay, Clarice, the environment, is it enabling?
The environment, just like she said, we cannot say that the environment is enabling. By the end of the day, you cannot sit and complain because the environment is not enabling or it's not conducive. So you have to be able to, you know, create the kind of environment that you believe or you want to. You believe is good enough for you to grow the way you are supposed to grow or to just be the way you're supposed to be, you know. So at the end of the day, I'll not say the environment is enabling. It's not enabling, but it is easier. Just like she said, it's better.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's better than when, like years back when we started, you know, doing what we're doing, or when I started, you know, being like a, or when I started believing in the fact that, okay, as a woman, I can, you know, I can be my own boss. I can, you know, there's a lot of things I can do. It's better now than then.
Yeah.
So, and I think it just keeps getting better because we keep getting enlightened about the way things are supposed to be or the way things are happening in other places.
Yeah.
So it's better than before, but it's not the best it could be.
Yeah, it could get better.
It could get better, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, now, Colette, you are a young woman and you are holding, you know, a top post in your company. Someone might be, you know, might want to think that it's easy for you, but even in that position, do you feel that you are getting the best of what you can get out of yourself as a woman?
Thank you, Amanda, for the question. Actually, I can say being a 21st century woman, normally there are challenges, issues that accompany, you know, the environment that we find ourselves in.
Mm-hmm.
Being in top management position in my company, normally there are challenges, issues that we have to deal with. First of all, I'm a woman, and the fact that I'm a woman, normally I have to deal with issues like there's a belief, you know, like it has always been in the decades, women are not supposed to, you know, hold top management positions in companies because they are the weaker minority, they are the weaker sex, they are supposed to be housewives. They are supposed to, you know, like just occupy, like on the bed.
Mm.
But when you come out to be the 21st century woman and you implicate yourself in a society, in a company, normally there are challenges that come about, like managing the work and the family.
Mm-hmm.
It's very difficult because you have to be a leader, you have to impact the people you are leading, you have to drive them towards accomplishing a particular goal.
Yeah.
And so, you know, with that, it's not really easy some at times because some men will say, you are a woman, you are not supposed to be my boss. So sometimes it's very challenging because you really want to give in your best, but just the fact that you are a woman, you know, it brings a lot of issues. Thirdly, the fact that sometimes you, for women that are married, you can be like, you are married, you have an income that is above that of your husband.
Mm-hmm.
At times, it's really like a problem because the husband will take it like some insubordination, which is not really the fact. But, you know, the fact that you are in that leading position, there is already a mentality. So that's why being a woman of the 21st century, we need to fight. We need to fight to impact the society, to change the mentalities.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes, like in where I'm a mother also, I have a son 3 years old. When I had my son, normally I had to go on maternity leave.
Yeah.
I had to deal with, you know, that pressure of thinking I was going to, you know, lose my position because, you know, my colleagues, you know, it was just like an opportunity. Let me go for the maternity leave so that on coming back, the position will be gone.
Mm.
Sometimes, you know, in other companies, it's like you go, you are a woman, when you get pregnant, when you are not available, the company can be on standby.
Yeah.
So it's already like, you know, like a discrepancy mm-hmm. when it has to come with the gender.
Right.
So I can say that on my personal note, it is not quite easy, but these are issues we need to deal with because we are women, we need to fight for them,
yeah.
we need to look for solutions.
Right, and we start getting the solutions when we start talking about the issues. And that's why we are dealing with this subject today on The Diary. Now, since you're really, I wanted to start with politics, but since we're already into economy, let's talk about that and mm-hmm. business. Now, there's a disparity between men and women when it comes to wages.
Mm-hmm.
Men generally get paid more for doing the same job that a woman does. Have mm-hmm. you ever had to experience that,
yeah,
Maria?
Yeah, sure.
Tell us about your experience.
Oh, well, not like I knew what another person was getting.
Okay.
Like I knew the figures, but I knew
mm-hmm.
that somebody was getting more than me.
Yeah.
Not only in Cameroon, even when I went out of Cameroon.
Mm-hmm.
It happens everywhere in the whole world. Like. Mm-hmm. I just saw some stats there not too long ago, and yes, they came up with that again. And you know, there have been campaigns all over the place. You know, you would be doing something like, mm-hmm. let me use an example. I was mm-hmm. in Brussels, and I was working in some organization, and I was, you know, the titles, you get the titles, it's funny, no problem.
Mm-hmm.
So I was what they would call regional manager for Africa, and there was somebody for Europe. Well, I don't know the number of countries each of these continents has exactly, but I think that Africa, well, and it's much more difficult to penetrate
Africa.
The continent of Africa and get
mm-hmm.
things done.
Mm-hmm.
And I was doing that all alone. And for that Europe, there was not just one person.
Mm-hmm.
There was the manager, and then there were like two or three other people.
Okay.
You know, but I knew that he was getting more than me. You know, but what could I do? You know, sometimes you just tell yourself, well, you just want the money, you don't want to trouble
mm-hmm.
after everything. But it hurt. Even the people who were working under him or working with him, the girls in particular, they were not really happy.
Mm-hmm.
So I could tell that there was also something even in that their own setup too. Yeah, so it makes women feel bad.
Yeah, I was going to ask, does it not affect a woman knowing that you're doing the same job a man is doing and the man is getting paid more than you?
Yeah, and then sometimes they kind of reproach you more than they reproach the man. And so women are held to a higher standard of performance than their male colleagues or the same level, and then they are paid less.
Mm-hmm. Quite ironical,
right?
Actually, now even when it comes to getting employment,
mm-hmm.
there are some jobs that women are denied simply because they are women.
They are women, exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah, their deals are not hard because I'm a woman.
Yeah.
Like, there are people I've approached for business deals, and I just because I'm a woman, they don't take me seriously. They're like, oh, what can she do? She's not probably going to be able to do it well. Like, you know, I've actually gotten into conversations with people, and they're like, okay, so you are the one leading this thing. Are you sure? Like, a lot of times people reach out to, okay, I'm a blogger, I run Better Things.
Yeah.
A lot of times people reach out to Better Things, and what they say is, yes, sir, or hello, sir.
Right.
Or hi,
nobody
bro.
Wants to
nobody believes
that
it's a woman that is running the blog. Even when I'm like, okay, a lot of times I just play along, you know, I just respond and then say what I have to say. I don't get into details of saying I'm a woman.
Mm-hmm.
And even when they get to discover that, they don't want to believe that it's a woman.
Mm-hmm.
Like, even when you correct them, I'm like, no, this is, they're like, are you sure that this is a woman? So a lot of times we deal with that, but it has made me to become better and better at what I do, because at the end of the day, I believe that it's only my work that's going to be able to, you know, justify
mm-hmm.
where I am or what I'm doing. So I believe that the better I am or the best I am at what I do, there's no way these people can discredit me. There's no way they can take this away from me. It is what I've worked for.
Yeah.
So I believe that a lot of people are going to want to, you know, those deals I lost, I just see them like, okay, I'm going to get better opportunities are going to come by because now I'm better. Because this disappointment has made me to be better, because now I have to work more to prove myself, you know, So it happens a lot.
Mm-hmm. And Colette, anything to add to that?
Yes, actually, my point of view on this, I would like to share my experience.
Please do.
Okay, when I started working in Douala, because I was in Bamenda, first of all, I worked in Bamenda for 3 years. So I got an opportunity in Douala. The first experience was they were looking for a storekeeper in that company.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. For security reasons, I'd like to withhold the name of the company.
Mm-hmm.
It's at the seaport. When I came, and the first approach I got, or the first remark was, you're a woman.
Mm-hmm.
This job It's not for women because it's a job that you have to, you know, put in extra hours. It's a bit, you know, you need a lot of energy. Sometimes, you know, you need to deal with a lot of people. Are you sure you'll be able to, capable of handling this? I said, yes, I'm capable. And I was the only woman for that opportunity, about 8 of us for that interview. I was the only woman, I was the youngest, so I had two problems, the gender and the age.
Right.
But at the end of the day, I had to fight, and I came out with the job.
Wow.
So all of the other men, they were looking at me, really? So you got the job? Are you sure you are okay? Are you sure you're not a, you know, like you haven't visited a traditional traditional, you know, doctor before coming here, just because I'm a woman? So it's like there is already that limitation.
Yeah.
The second experience I would like to share is that particular company. I was later promoted because of my hard work to be head of department for procurement, traffic, and the commercial. So I was managing 3 departments.
Wow.
Just as she said, I could not get, my salary was not like half of what the other head of departments were managing, were getting. I was managing 3 departments, but what I was getting was not equivalent to what one head of department, which was a man, was getting. So I had to deal with that. And I was not discouraged. You know, I kept on fighting. I kept on, you know, putting my effort. I kept on doing my job well, you know. It happens. You know, these are daily, you know, situations, realities. But we don't need to be discouraged. We need to keep pushing, preaching the gospel, you know, of gender inequality, so that people can, you know, absorb into their minds that the fact that you are a woman doesn't disqualify you from getting advantages, the same advantages like a man.
Yeah,
I agree with you completely. And let's talk about women working with men. Say a woman is a boss or the head of department in a company, and you have men who work under you. Is it easy for a woman to maintain that position and work properly, like get the respect she deserves from her subordinates who are men? Does it come easy?
When I was working somewhere in this Douala, in a telecommunications company, I had a colleague, male colleague, and I have male colleagues. Okay, and then we had a supervisor who was a woman. I saw sometimes some of those male colleagues talk to her or behave around her like, whatever, whether you are supervisor or manager or whatsoever, you know, you just get that feeling that, you're a woman. So you don't have to put pressure on them, for example, and stuff like that. And we, or me, for example, in particular, I mean, I respected her. I was like, she's my supervisor, she's the manager. But I used to be like, just put me in that position, I'll put them in their place. Because I just think that it's not fair. And I think that it's because of all this patriarchy and all this cultural thing, and children start growing, and at some point you start seeing the boy, even if a girl is a bigger sister, he thinks that because he's the boy, then he can disrespect.
And sometimes the parents encourage that.
Of course, also, now. Yeah. So they grow with that and then end up in society also thinking that even if their boss is a woman, then she's just a woman.
Yeah. They say a man is a man, even if he's 2 years old, he's a man and he deserves to be treated a particular way.
Women, as long as there's a man there, it is they or he or what.
Yeah. That's true. And Clarice, on the same subject, do you think it's easy for women to work with men who who work under her? Is it easy?
It's not easy, but at the end of the day, I just feel like if you are given a post of responsibility and you have authority, you should exercise the authority.
Yeah.
So if you are a boss and you have subordinates, whether they are men or women, treat them accordingly. Don't let anybody disrespect you because you are a woman. Because if you have a post of authority, it is for you to exercise the authority. If people come and they trample on you and you let them trample on you, it's because you allow them to trample on you.
Right.
In my case, I've had to lead several projects I'm working on, since most of the projects I work on are my projects. So I'm the one who chooses the people that work with me. And on several occasions, I've had to, should I say, fire or, you know, cut off my engagement with a lot of people just because they were disrespecting me.
Yeah.
You cannot be working with me and then you disrespect me.
Yeah.
For me, it's not like, it's not even supposed to be a gender thing, it's supposed to be a human thing.
Yeah.
If you are working with somebody, give the person the respect that the person deserves. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, I think that people should be able to exercise that authority that they have. Don't feel it, because some women feel intimidated and they think it's normal. Like, okay, if somebody is, you know, treating you some type of way, you think that anyway, it's okay, let me just take it, it's normal. It's not normal. You are the one that has to impose who you are on them. If you don't give them that, you know, platform to respect you, they'll just continue to disrespect you.
Question: for a woman who has been groomed mm-hmm. from childhood to believe that the man first always, mm-hmm. the man is superior always, how does she change today and say, I am the boss, I make the rules?
Mm-hmm.
How do you help a woman like that to change?
The thing is, for a woman like that to change, she first of all has to know who she is.
Mm.
Like, if you don't know who you are, if you don't know that, okay, I'm a boss, if you don't know that I have authority, if you don't know that I deserve respect, then you continue to just, you know, let this disrespect and other things happen to you.
Mm-hmm.
So first of all, you need to know who you are. And for you to know who you are, you need to educate yourself about your potential as a woman, as a person, your gifts, your skills, your abilities,
yeah.
your educational background, your academic accomplishments. Like, all of those make you who you are. So you need to know that this is who I am. If you're a managing director, you need to, okay, I'm a managing director, and I act accordingly. Because a lot of times, some of these women who are the ones that give room for disrespect.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you have a certain role, and you don't act according to your role, you give people room to disrespect you. Some women, you know, go around, they have subordinates that are men, and they flirt with those subordinates. Start mm-hmm. flirting with a man who disrespects you. You know, so a lot of times you need to know who you are and carry yourself accordingly.
Right.
So it's going to, when you carry yourself accordingly, it's going to be easy for these people to give you respect that you deserve. Yeah.
Now, for you, Colette, I imagine it's a daily reality, because yeah. I believe that there are men who work under you.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah. what's it like for you?
Actually, on that note, it's really a challenge sometimes, because the fact that you're a woman, some men cannot deal with that.
And you're a very young woman
and their boss. Some men cannot deal with that. So sometimes, you know, you talk, you give instructions, you delegate, because, you know, you cannot be a leader without having a team.
Yeah.
Normally, you need to have a team. So it makes it difficult, because you cannot manage a team.
Mm-hmm.
It's like you're trying to gather, you're trying to make people to see this in the same vision, but they are trying to, like, detach themselves from the team.
Mm-hmm.
So on that note, it's very difficult. But as we have been saying, it's just to pull yourself and, you know, try to get through with your authority. And no matter, you know, how disrespectful or how the man look at it, it should not stop you.
Mm-hmm.
On the other side, some women, you know, like in top management position, because sometimes I have, you know, some colleagues and some people that are friends, that some tend to be, you know, rude, because the man does not respect them. The fact that they are a woman and they are a leader, or they're in a management position or a hierarchy in a company, mm-hmm. the men don't respect them. So they tend to be rude, they tend to be snobbish, they tend to be bossy. You know what we call it? This boss, the boss lady.
Mm-hmm.
The boy, not really a leader.
Iron lady.
So you tend to change your mood, because you are managing men, and the fact that you are a minority, you are not supposed to be a leader.
Mm-hmm.
On the other side, sometimes you give instructions and, you know, people don't follow. You tend to follow your emotions to, like, no, you know, we women, we are sometimes like, I'm a mother. We have that way of, you know, caressing and
yeah.
trying to, you know, gather people, trying to arrange. But sometimes it doesn't work like that.
Mm-hmm.
There are times you need to arrange.
You have to put emotions aside.
Yeah.
So some women tend to fall in that trap of, you know, when they are in that position, they put their emotions in front. No, mm-hmm. It's not correct. So mm-hmm. whatever you need to do, you need to put your emotions aside, and you need to manage accordingly, because it's a task that has been given to you, because they believe in you. Because a woman, actually, from my point of view, is the best leader, and is supposed to be a leader more than a man, because from birth, we are the ones giving life.
Mm-hmm.
We are the
I ones agree with you completely.
Bringing life. We are the ones bringing, you know, life. So we have the potential mm. to nurture our babies. It's the same
yeah.
thing in the society, in the company. We have to nurture this, because we have the potentials.
Right.
Right.
That's correct. Now, something I've been thinking about. when I was in school, when I was in the university, mm-hmm. in my class, 80% of the students were girls. But once I started working, I realized that it was the reverse. Now, I cannot confirm, I don't know whether for every profession it's the same. But how do we explain that there are more girls in schools than there are girls actually practicing whatever profession it is, if it is true? Correct me if I'm wrong, I can make mistakes too. Mm-hmm. But how do we explain that? Because it's contrasting. Why would I see many students, female students in school, and then when it comes to the offices where they are supposed to practice what they learned in school, it's the opposite?
Well, because even when you're going to that school, somewhere at the back of your mind, settling down is not about practicing school thing. Mm. Settling down, when you hear about settling down, what do you think about?
When I hear about settling down, I think about getting married.
Well, so many girls think about settling down, and the age for settling down is in your like mid-20s, starting from there mm-hmm. to about early 30s, right? Mm-hmm. So when you finish school, maybe at 22, 23, you are thinking about settling down traditionally.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you are not thinking about going to put what you learn in school into practice. Mm-hmm. That is why in the beginning, even sending a girl to school was considered a waste of resources.
Even today, some girls still have to struggle.
Yeah, so it's like, even when you go to that school, I like using personal examples. When I left school, mm-hmm. honestly, I was also thinking about settling down. Mm-hmm. So it means that even if I started doing anything, if the possibility or the opportunity of settling down came, I was prepared to stop. Mm-hmm. And that is why some women will get married and, well, will have to give up that career mm-hmm. or stuff to focus on the settling down. Mm-hmm. And I also was one of such women, but somewhere along the line, some small stubbornness came because I wasn't happy. And so I decided to continue with the pursuit of my career. That's a whole story, but yes, so, and even my sister, I'm asking my sister today, what do you want to do? Well, when she finishes, she wants to get married. And then, well, she wants to teach. So you see, you're in school, we are many. Mm-hmm. But what is at the back of our mind as we are in school?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
And talk about the difference between gender. Men settle down, mm-hmm. but that doesn't stop them from working. Right. But when a woman thinks about settling down, she thinks about playing the housewife, the role of the housewife, who stays home, takes care of the babies. How do we get girls to change, to know that you can be a wife, mm-hmm. a mother, and still have your career?
Right. It's education. At the end of the day, I just think it's an issue of education. Mm-hmm. So, moms, as we are now, we are enlightened, so we can educate our children. Mm-hmm. I think it's about education, and then, because most of these girls have this belief because that's what they saw growing up, maybe.
Right.
Maybe in their homes, their moms were not working, their fathers were the ones bringing money home. So they believe that that's how it should be. But and another thing is also some girls are just, they just feel intimidated, and they think it's, they think that's what life is. Mm-hmm. Anyway, at the end of the day, I just believe that every girl, the first thing is you should know who you are, know your potential, mm-hmm. and know what you want to be. Because there are some people whose dreams are being those kind of women that just sit at home and don't do anything. Mm-hmm. There are some women that's their career. Some women call themselves soccer moms. Like your son, maybe you have kids that are playing football. Mm-hmm. Your own is just to take care of those kids, make sure they go to school. That's for them, it's a whole career and they are contented. Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, though, I think that there's a lot more that women can offer to the society, and that's what we should be striving towards.
Yeah.
So it should be an issue of education. As a mom, guide your children at home that, okay, if your child is excelling in this and your child wants to be this, let the child flourish in that.
Yeah.
I make the child to believe that you can be this and you can actually still get married, have kids. Yeah. There's no limitation to who you can be, and that's just what we are preaching. Mm-hmm. Because I think this is an issue of education. And another thing is because it's true that there are some girls that like the easy way out. Mm-hmm. That there's some girls that believe that, you're going to work every day, it's too stressful. I don't want to stress. Let me just get married to one rich Alhaji that come and take care of me. Why should I be working for money when there's a man that can marry me and take care of me? Some girls believe that that's an end goal. And then when they find themselves in that situation, they are not happy.
Right.
Because you're home every day. You don't have anything to do. You're thinking, okay, your husband goes out. You think whether he has gone, he's cheating. But if you're working, you'll not be thinking about where your husband is, whether he's working or he's doing something else. Like, all that stress is not going to... There's this story I know of a very personal friend of mine, mm-hmm. who was in that kind of situation. She got married. Her husband is very, very wealthy. So In the beginning, she was like, I don't need to work. Why? What am I working for? So she was content. But after a couple of years, like 2 years later, she was like, I cannot live this life. I cannot be sitting in the house every day. I'm not going to work. This is not my life. Like, I need to do something. And she learned a trade. And now she's doing catering and all of that.
Nice.
So, you know, it's besides the laziness and lack of education, I just think that women and girls should just, you know, empower themselves more. Get to discover yourself more. Explore your gifts. Mm-hmm. Whatever talent you have, you know, explore it and just leave it.
Yeah.
If you are the kind of person that, okay, you believe that you want to stay at home, get a job that can permit you to stay at home.
Yeah.
Because there are things you can do from the house.
Exactly.
There are a lot of jobs you can do from the house. Mm-hmm. If you are not a 9-to-5 kind of person, look for something that, look for a business and run. Look for, explore your passion. Mm-hmm. If you like to cook, then be cooking, you know, as a business.
Yeah.
Instead of just, you know, sitting and then not doing anything, mm-hmm. you know, yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
It's great that things are changing. Women are getting more and more aware. They are
exactly.
getting more emancipated. From what I've gathered so far, it would seem that, well, in some cases, in some instances, mm-hmm. women create the limitations for themselves.
Yeah.
Because if you just want to stay home and not work, if you just want a man that provides everything, then it's going to affect how that man and other men look at you.
At you.
Don't
exactly.
you think so, Colleen?
Exactly.
Yeah, you are very right.
Exactly.
Actually, because the way you create your society, the way you create your environment, it determines the way the society looks at a woman as a whole and looks at you. I don't think being a woman stops you from becoming anything in life.
Yeah. Exactly.
Because the first thing is you need to believe in yourself.
Mm-hmm.
If you believe in yourself, I think there is nothing that can stop you from going to wherever you want to go.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
As you said before, 80% of the population while we're in school days are women.
Mm-hmm.
But on the contrary, in the society, in offices, in companies, we have lesser than 22% of women working and holding management positions. So you see, it all begins with us, the women, because we've decided to embrace, you know, that like our destiny, because
mm-hmm.
we don't believe in the fact that there are potentials in us that we can bring out.
Yeah.
And when it starts with that, you first of all don't believe in yourself. Secondly, you don't work hard,
mm-hmm.
you are lazy, as she said, then you cannot go to anywhere.
Right.
On the other side, if you know you have something in you, you believe in yourself, you push, you work hard, and you educate yourself, you mm-hmm. educate the society, then why not become, you know, whatever you want to become in the future?
Right.
Good question.
Yeah.
Now, since we already mentioned education, let's talk a bit about education. Mm-hmm. Now, there are some women. Once I had the show, I was talking about women and schooling and, you know, in relation to men and marriage. And someone called and said his wife wanted to go to school to get a master's degree. And he was not fine with that because he cannot accept that his wife goes to get a master's degree because it's going to change how his wife thinks. Now, many men today believe that the higher a woman goes to school, the more stubborn she becomes and the more insubordinate she gets. Is that true though?
Yeah, well, look, I shared a post on Facebook yesterday and some troll, I'll call him a troll. I just refuse to comment on all the comments he's making there. He's not even my friend, so it's just somebody who's commenting. I keep saying that, yeah, all these empowerment things have made women something else. That was not our African tradition and whatever. I'm just like, whatever, you know. So I'm letting other people give it to him. I'm just like, I'm not even deleting your comments. Other people should see how people still think today.
Yeah.
So that is it. They think that way. Let me use my personal examples.
Please do.
All the time.
Please do.
My husband once called me avocat pourri. He will remind me that your lawyer thing, don't bring it here. And I never, I'm the person, if you know me, if you have followed me, I'm this simple person, like giving the makeup thing. Not, I'm just like, life, let's live, you know, mm-hmm. but people are just intimidated.
Right.
And I think it's some complex.
Mm-hmm.
They will not use that word because their ego doesn't want them to admit
mm-hmm.
that they are insecure. But for me, that is what it is, right?
Yeah.
Like, why? What says that? I've also seen other men who have married women who are so everything, and they're just so full of, what are we talking about? Michelle Obama. Have you ever heard Barack Obama complain about her having, whether it's a Jewish this or whatsoever, or Oprah's man complain mm-hmm. that, oh, she's because of all the... So why are they in our society? And let me say they in generalization, but well, majority of them, that's the truth about it. Why are they intimidated? Why?
Right. It's a good question.
Whereas, to conclude, the more educated she is, the more she can contribute to the well-being of the home, right?
Yeah.
Economically and everything. So, I don't know.
Okay. The other side, the flip side of the coin, Clarice. Some, I read stories of women who, once they get empowered, sometimes it's education, sometimes it's financially, they change. They forget their roles that they have to perform as wives, as parents. Have you ever come across that?
I've heard stories, right? And I think that the truth is that if somebody changes, they're just revealing who they were.
Okay.
It's not about what happened to them. It's about who they were.
Okay.
Or who they have always been.
Okay.
But then this new enlightenment has just revealed this other side of them. Mm-hmm. Just like some people say money changes people, but money does not. Many people have not changed because they had money.
Yeah.
A lot of times, it's not even the people that change. It's you who is around them that has changed.
Mm-hmm.
Because somebody is rich now, you just feel like, oh, if I call her now, she'll think that I want to beg her for money. Meanwhile, she's still your friend. Mm-hmm. Call her and say hello and she'll respond, you know. A lot of times I think that some of these women who behave this way, it's not the money or the education that changed them. It's who they were that has just, you know, been revealed.
Yeah.
There's some people that are normally arrogant, but because they don't have money, they cannot express their arrogance. Yes, you cannot be broke and you're insulting people. But when you have people under you, now you can insult, you can express that arrogant
true
nature.
Self.
Yes. So it's about who you were. It's not really about the education because any woman that is empowered, when you become empowered, you it instead humbles you because you when you know many things you start to see I can be better. You start seeing how you can actually change your environment. You can, this thing you have learned, you want people around you to learn it. You are not thinking about how I should suppress these people.
Yeah.
You are thinking about how I should instead nurture these people, how I should help, I should make them to know this thing that I know, or how I should, you know, spread this new energy that I've learned. You're not thinking about how I should trample on them. You know, it's like a woman, if you go and learn like how to cook, or for example, if you learn new skills, maybe if you learn how to cook an Italian dish, you are hearing that, okay, let me come and cook this thing in my house, let my kids and my husband eat and enjoy. You're not thinking that, oh, now that I know how to cook Italian, nobody will eat Italian in this house. If you're thinking like that, then you are that's who you are. You're an evil person. So it's not education that changes people, and men that usually think like that are men, that these men are intimidated, is a matter of lack of self-confidence.
Yeah.
Because if as a man you are confident about your responsibility as a man, you're confident that you're the head of the house, you're confident that you're a leader in the home, your wife's empowerment should not, you should be happy, you should be cheering her up, like, okay, now that she has learned this new thing, she'll come and teach my kids, she'll come and teach me, she'll come and make, she'll be a better wife. You know, that's what should be running through your mind. So at the end of the day, men that think like that, just like the women that they say change, I don't believe they change.
Yeah.
They just express that nature. Men that express that nature, those are men that have been insecure from the word go.
Yeah.
And they have been having this complex that they have been dealing with. And now that their wife is this new, they're like, oh, now that she's like this, she's going to be, nah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Colette, I almost know what you're going to say, but asking the question, on what side are you? Does education empower a woman, or does it just make her stubborn and insubordinate?
Actually, I'm going to talk on both sides.
Okay.
Let me take the positive. I think education is supposed to empower a woman, let's say, more better than she was. Because when you get a better education, you know how to deal with people, you know how to treat people, you know how to, you know, handle cases, because you are empowered with that knowledge. But when you are, you know, void and you are empty, so you cannot be a better woman. But on the other side, education has made a lot of women become very insubordinate. On the other side, some women, they take it like, you know, it's a platform for they to showcase, you know, as she said, some of those negativities that were already living in them. So they're just looking for that platform, like, I'm educated, I have a master's degree, my husband maybe he has just an advanced level, So I am supposed to be insubordinate to my husband. I'm supposed to disrespect my husband. I'm supposed to be rude. I'm not supposed to do my duties in the house or mm-hmm. to play my role as a mother mm-hmm. because of the education.
Yeah.
So I think that if anybody who is, any woman who is seeing it, like education should be a platform or a means of, you know, showcasing the negativity, you are mm-hmm. getting it all wrong, because yeah. when you do that, then you are not educated, you are suffering from mental poverty.
Exactly. Yeah.
That's true. And yeah, it's a crying
mental
shame.
Poverty, really. So many people don't know that. There are many people that have gone through, passed through schools, but the school has not passed through them. So it's not because you have this degree, mm-hmm. whatever, that makes you educated. Mm-hmm. So there's somebody that maybe has not gone to school, but you see the way she manages things, because she has the will.
Mm-hmm.
She has the will. She believes in herself.
Right.
She sees life positive. Mm-hmm. But when you have a negative way of seeing life, trust me, you are going to get negative results.
Exactly. Let's talk about negative results and negative mm-hmm. actions.
Mm-hmm.
As much as I'm a big supporter of the woman, I'm a woman, mm-hmm. I want the best for women. We've talked about this before, mm-hmm. Clarice. Feminism nowadays. Mm-hmm. There are lots of feminists out there,
mm-hmm.
and you're one. We're in trouble. Clarice and I. No, but anyways, you clarified me once. Maybe mm-hmm. she's probably going to join you. Now, on paper, feminism seems ideal. It's amazing. But when you look at it in practice, and the people, and some of the people mm-hmm. who defend it, questions arise.
Mm-hmm.
When we say feminism nowadays, to you, what's feminism, Maria? Let's start with you.
Oh, no. For me, it's my personal thing, actually. Okay. Mm-hmm. Like being the best person I can be mm-hmm. without any limitation imposed by any society, mm-hmm. anybody, and refusing to be unequal for whatsoever reason, be it religion, tradition, culture, yeah. all of those. And accepting that, that is what feminism for me is, accepting my right
mm-hmm.
to equality mm-hmm. as a human being.
Right.
Okay.
There's nothing, there's no reason for whatsoever why I shouldn't be an equal human being with a man.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
No reason.
Right.
We are supposed to be equal human beings.
Okay.
Seriously. And I think that when we accept that, now there are different ways of accepting, and some ways produce different kinds of results. Mm-hmm. And some ways are interpreted differently, and there's always a backlash. It's not today that it started, is it today? Yeah, and even when we were the first women fighting for the right to vote, oh my goodness, fight. So it is not going to stop now. So what I do is that kind of Meghan Markle kind of way,
mm-hmm.
the subtle one. I just continue going and doing my thing,
right.
and passing the message. So that's how it is for me.
Okay, yeah. What do you say to women who believe that feminism is, a man doesn't have to tell me what to do. I do what I want to do, how I want to do it. You know, I am my own person. If I decide what I want to do, that's how I go about it. What do you have to say to that?
Well, I mean, if it works for you like that, but the thing is that no human being is an island. We live in a society, and there are relationships.
Right.
So if it's going to affect it, and you're not going to, it's not going to be balanced anymore, mm-hmm. and then the well-being of society, then you have to think about it again.
Right.
Right.
You don't want to cause more havoc than there already is, right? Saying you're that kind of feminist.
Mm-hmm.
So you really have to think about it. But I don't want to pass any, I don't know whether it's judgment or whatever. I just think that the bottom line is, what makes the most sense to you?
Okay, right.
Mm-hmm.
On the subject, Clarice.
Yeah.
Yes, we've talked about it. We'll talk about it again today.
Right.
It's an issue that concerns women. The feminist movement.
Mm-hmm.
Women who think that because you're a feminist, or who considers herself a feminist and says she's a wife, for example,
mm-hmm.
I'm not going to clean. Or if I'm going to clean 3 times, or I don't know, yeah, say 3 days,
mm-hmm.
you're going to clean the remaining 4 days.
Right.
If I cook today, mm-hmm. you're going to cook tomorrow,
mm-hmm.
because we are equal. And it's the woman's world. What do you have to say to that?
That's many people get it wrong. People mistake feminism for gender roles.
Right.
Gender roles are different from gender equality. Gender roles, a man can never ever give birth to a child because a man does not have a womb.
Right.
So that's your role. It's your role as a woman. It's a gender role. Your husband can never ever get pregnant. You are the one that will get pregnant. You're the one that's going to give birth to the children. Mm-hmm. So people confuse gender roles and gender equality. They think that when we're saying that, men and women are equal, we're saying that if a woman cooks today, a man should cook tomorrow. That's not what it is about. That's gender roles, it's different. Mm-hmm. The equality, like she mentioned, is about saying that, okay, as a woman, it's basic. I think every good human being should be a feminist, because who is a feminist? It's just somebody who believes that women have the right to be who they want to be, express themselves the way they want to express themselves. They should not be discriminated upon. A woman should go to school, a woman should vote, a woman should work. That's what we're saying. We're not saying that a woman, that if you have a company, you should fire all the men and put only women there. That's not what we're saying. Mm-hmm. We're saying that if you have a company and a woman is competent enough to work in that company, let her work in the company. Mm-hmm. That's what feminism is all about.
Right.
And as a human being, I think it should be a basic instinct that everybody should have. Mm-hmm. You should believe that everybody should be treated according to the way they deserve to be treated, not because she's a woman, you will not allow her to work. If she has the competence, she has the skills, she should work. That's what we're saying. Mm-hmm. If you have citizens or people who are 21 years should be able to vote. If a woman is 21 years, she has her voting card, let her vote. That's what we're saying. We're not saying that you should say, oh, no man should vote, only women should come and vote because only women should decide. Mm-hmm. That's not what we are saying. If you have women in politics and a woman who is a politician is competent enough to run a certain, to go for elections, whatever, and she should go for elections. Don't say that, no, don't go for elections. That's what feminism is about.
Right.
But many people mistake it for saying that, we're equal. So today, if the woman changes, if the woman that buys this one, or the man should buy this one, or that's not what feminism is about.
Yeah, but unfortunately, I've not carried out any studies. I don't have any statistics, but I'm saying some women unfortunately have misconstrued it, and they are breeding a group of women, so even girls, who are being misled sometimes.
Some of those,
to the extreme.
The thing is, those kind of people, I usually call them toxic feminists. Mm-hmm. And if you look at those toxic feminists, they usually have history. Most of them, I hate men for a reason. Like, some of those women are expressing their hate towards men. It's not even about feminism anymore. Because some of those women don't treat women, but they don't treat women well.
Right.
If you look at some of those women and go and say, okay, if I'm in a house, if my baby is crying and I carry him when I change his diaper, the next time he cries, I'm not picking him up. Mm-hmm. My husband has to go and pick him up. If you look at those women, they have deep rooted issues. They don't know who they are. Like, they don't believe in themselves as a woman. Because, for example, in a home situation, if you have a child, if you have a husband, as a woman, you normally have that nurturing, you know.
Yeah.
When you go home, your first thing is, okay, I need to make sure my baby has eaten. I need to make sure my husband has eaten. That's what love is about.
Yeah.
You're not thinking that, oh, did my husband cook yesterday? He not cook yesterday. So today, if they like, they don't eat in this house, it's not concern me. That, you don't love your kids, you don't love your husband. So that's not what feminism is about. Women have usually go and say those things. Some of these women, that if you look at them, they don't even care about women. Mm-hmm. Like, you see, they go and go to social media and they're like, oh, as a woman, know your rights. If this happens, this and that. How do they treat other women? Most of those women don't treat women. They don't even care about women. Like, if you go to where they're working, because a lot of times women's problems are women.
Okay.
You go to some company situations, some of the women are oppressing other women are women. There's a women that see this route and they see, okay, this place is bad. And they see another young girl going there, they'll not tell her, oh, come here, don't go this way. Mm-hmm. They don't care because it has happened to me, it should happen to you. So those are the kind of women that usually go.
And come and shame you after that.
Mm-hmm. Those are the kind of women that usually go and they're like, those are the toxic feminists that we're talking about. Real feminism is not violence. It's not rebellious. Some women are just being rebellious. So, and like, going back to what we're talking about before, like, okay, these women that feel intimidated by women, I'm like, or these women that when they get maybe better education or better, you know, salary or whatever, and they come and they insult their husbands, I think that sometimes it's really as a form of rebellion. Like, you have been in that home and that man has been maybe maltreating you, because there's women that go through a lot of emotional trauma, they don't even know. And then something happens and then you know that, oh, I could have money like this, I'm going to deal with this man now. And they start, you know, insulting the man. Sometimes it's rebellion because of what they have been dealing with, and then they have an opportunity to just, you know, burst out, and they just get angry and they just start misbehaving. So at the end of the day, I just think it's just toxicity, as you say. Yeah.
And Colette, what's your take on feminism today?
Actually, on a brighter note, I think to be a feminist is your strive for gender equality,
right,
as the others have said. But on the negative side, I think it doesn't mean that because you're a feminist, you should, like, you know, take the man to be, like, it's like a fight.
Mm-hmm.
Normally, you have to prove a point. but it should not be rebellious, as she said. So on the other side, if you are as a feminist, I see, like, normally that if I'm in a house with my husband, we have both parties have roles to play.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
The man has a role to play, and the woman has a role to play. It doesn't mean that because they consider the woman as a housewife, maybe you are working and you have to come back from work, your husband maybe comes back a bit earlier than you, and maybe it's just like to buy, maybe like help purchase gas from the station.
Yeah.
He will not do that because that job is like assigned for a woman. Normally it's not supposed to be like that. We have to share. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry. In Europe, you do A, I do B. Mm-hmm. So I think on the motive, we should be able to like share. If I do this, the man does that. It's not like we are doing it in a rebellious way, but it should be like because we are a team. Teamwork is not all about being in a company, mm-hmm. being in a society, being in an organization. In the house, it's also teamwork.
Yeah,
it's also teamwork. So if I mop the floor, then maybe you can help, maybe to start cooking. I can join you later. I know many women will look at me like I'm a bit crazy, but
I can bet
these are realities of life.
That's the truth.
And you see many women today, they die because, first of all, they leave from the office, they have to come back, they are the ones to check if the child has done the homework. The man is there sleeping, sitting on the couch, watching television, reading the newspaper. Mm-hmm. But a woman has to come back from work. She has to cook food. She has to check the child. If the child is picking up in school, the homework is, if it has been done. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, but I don't share that. I don't share that view.
Mm-hmm.
If we women, the women in Africa have decided to embrace that, I think we need to change.
Mm-hmm.
We need to change our mentalities because
right.
it's the way is the information, the education we give out mm-hmm. that makes, you know, the society to become what it is.
Right.
So like just to add to what she said, right, I just believe that this thing is a love thing. If we're in a family setting,
mm-hmm.
right, if we're in a family setting and you come back home, you know that, okay, you come home earlier, there's nothing wrong with you cooking. Now, this has got nothing to do with a man and woman. This is about two people living together.
Yeah.
It's basic survival instinct. Yeah. It's not about making life easier for the next person. If you're in school, even when you're in the boarding school, you're your friend, sometimes you help your friend to carry water. It's not because she's a man or a woman.
Yeah.
You are helping her because she's your friend and you want to make life easy for her.
Yeah.
If you're married to a woman who is, you know, more engaged in the professional field like you, if she comes back late and you come back earlier, and I have friends who, like, I know a friend where her mother was working more than her father. So her father used to come home earlier, he comes home, he cooks. There's nothing wrong with that. Now that does not make him less than a man because he has right. cooked for his kids. They are his kids.
Completely.
They are his children. That's where this toxicity comes, because there's some men that are just, they have this toxic masculinity that I cannot enter the kitchen. Because that's toxicity. That. Don't you eat? So it's at the end of the day, if a woman comes home and she's doing all those things, it's because she cares about her family. She wants to nurture her family.
Yeah.
Same as a man, it is your family too.
Right.
So you should care. This is your child. I'm not the only one that's supposed to educate the child. Yeah. You know. So it's supposed to be in a family setting. It's supposed to be about companionship and working together. It's not a man and a woman thing.
That's true.
Mm-hmm.
Now let's talk about sexism.
Mm-hmm.
Today, women. Not today, I don't think it's starting today. For as long as I can remember, for as long as I've been reading,
mm-hmm.
the woman has always been sexualized by the man.
Mm-hmm.
Men see women as objects,
right.
They can own you, they can buy you, they can dispose of you. How do you feel as a woman? How do you feel when you imagine that a man sees you as an object?
Mm-hmm.
Well, it is now me. The way I feel about myself,
mm-hmm.
I'm not more bothered about how a man sees me.
Yeah.
To the point where I shove it to them in their face, and they cannot touch me. I mean, I flaunt my body. I take care of myself, and I just, seriously, I'm like paying them back, because yes, for a while it was like that, and they kind of made it look like if they cannot, you know, like grab you, they cannot. I once did a live video. I talked about sexual assault in the office. I've been a victim, so I know these kind of things, and I don't have me no problem talking about these things.
Yeah.
But now I'm in a position where I can be me, so like this and you cannot do nothing about that, and it is wrong. Mm-hmm. It actually shows how insecure they are by thinking that they need to keep putting women down in one way or the other so that they can stay there and gratify their ego.
Right.
You know, and that is what my own style of feminism is trying to break it down for them so that they come back and let's stay at the same level. What is this whole thing? Why? You know, like, if you wear a short skirt, they have to make a comment about it. You know, they have to talk about your thighs. They have to, what is all of that focus? What, I don't know, small minds.
Right.
When you see somebody, instead of thinking about the sense that can come out of this person, the discussion you can have, the possibilities, the business opportunity, all of that, you are then looking at their body, their skirt, their shape, their legs. And I laugh at those kind of comments on Facebook and everywhere, and I just keep showing it to them now.
And Clarice? she needs a second.
Right. Okay, so for me, this issue about seeing women as sexual objects, the thing is very unfortunate that many women are used to it. Many of us, in short, I am used to it. Like, when I go out, I want to take a taxi, you know, you start on the road, the bike will come and pass. Like the first thing that they're looking at is maybe your breast. You know, I'm already, and now when it happens, I just laugh. At first, I used to get angry, but now I cannot even get angry anymore. I just laugh. Because when I was growing up, when I was like 13, I really started having breasts. So I used to feel very uncomfortable about my breasts because my chest was like, I was having breasts. And I used to feel uncomfortable because when I leave the house and I'm walking anywhere, people start shouting, "Miss Lolo, Miss Lolo, I'm 13 years old." So I used to hate the fact that I had big breasts.
Yeah.
It took me a while until I got more mature and I embraced my big breasts. I'm like, these are my breasts. There's nothing I can do about it.
Yeah.
And this is because men made me to feel like breasts are sexual objects.
Yeah.
I feel uncomfortable. I'm walking and I'm just trying to hide. Like the way I bend my back like this so they should not see, but I'm walking and she shouts, "Miss Lolo, Miss Lolo." So I used to be, so those are the things. No. So it happens and it plays on your confidence, but at the end of the day you're like, but these people cannot control my life. I cannot be walking and be hiding my body, hiding who I am because I have big breasts. Did I create myself? No. You know, so at the end of the day, I think that, you know, sexism is an issue that women will always deal with. I don't think that this thing is going to end anytime soon. But as a woman, you should be able to have respect for yourself, because if those men are calling you Miss Lolo and you go and start laughing, then you start flying, "Yeah, Miss Lolo," and then, you know, give them the access to touch the Lolo, do whatever they have to do the Lolo.
Right.
You have indulged in whatever it is they are calling you, and now you have become an object. The object that they saw you as, you have become that.
Yeah.
So at the end of the day, you as a human, you should be able to have that respect for yourself. Don't indulge these people. You know, because it's not going to end. If you don't start fighting all the men that will stop you in the world, you will fight every day. So. Just, you know, at the end of the day, as a human, carry yourself with respect. So no matter how, if they are looking at you as a sexual object, let it be on them. Let it not be on you.
Mm-hmm.
Another thing is that women use that. It's very unfortunate that some women that see it as okay. Like, there's some women that, okay, if they enter an office and everybody is saying, "Oh, wow, she has nice legs, she has nice," they're happy.
Yeah, and they feel like
they feel like they have won. That's a problem. Women that have that thought, and women that don't know who they are, they don't have any other skill, they don't have any potential, they feel like their body is everything, and because I have this body now, this is what I'm with, this is my, I don't know, my pass mark to get any job, to get anything. If you have that kind of mentality, then you are enabling the sexual gratification that men give to you. You are enabling
You are contributing to the problem.
You are part of the problem. So as a woman, the only way we can stop this is by knowing who we are and having respect for ourselves.
Yeah.
Have respect for your body. Know that, okay, this body is my body. Nobody should disrespect my body. Don't give them the opportunity to disrespect your body.
Right.
That's the only thing you can do. You cannot change the way they think, because they always think the way they think, but you have to give your body that respect.
Yeah.
And when you give their body that respect, trust me, nobody can take it away from you.
True.
Yes, that respect is going to be there. When you enter that room, you'll be the woman with distinction. You'll be the woman when you enter, people like, but this girl, even though they are saying that, oh, she has big breasts, she has big buttocks, she has big this, but nobody is going to be there that's going to probably say, I've used her, oh, she's this, because you have given yourself that respect. So it's going to be a fantasy only to their small minds.
Yeah.
It's not going to take away anything from you. Mm-hmm. But when you indulge them by playing along with that game, then you are part of the problem and you will suffer the consequences.
Yeah.
Right. And
Clarice has talked about it a bit, but I still wanted to ask you this question.
Okay.
Women, there are women who are actually championing, making the problem bigger than it should be.
Right.
Women who decide to use their bodies to get what they want. Clarice said it's all they have. They feel like that's all they can use, you know, to get what it is. they need or what it is they want, and they are the reason why the problem persists.
Right.
What do you think can be said of these women, and how do other women who finally are the victims of these other women who contribute to the problem, how do they manage it? How do we get people to change?
Mm-hmm. I think, as Clary said, madam, sexism is an issue that we need to deal with because it's evident. Mm-hmm. Because the opposite sex, the male, you know, they have already like a mentality, like we are in this position. This is how they consider us to be. But we need to prove, you know, the contrary of mm-hmm. their thoughts.
Mm-hmm.
Because this is what they think. You have big breasts. You have nice legs. Your eyes are like, I don't know,
mm-hmm.
the names to call. But we need to, you know, enable them to see, you know, the other side, like the contrary of their views. Because this is what they think. And mm-hmm. I think the make being for them to think like that is because actually they are limited. Yes, mm-hmm. they are limited because you cannot be somebody that's well educated and it's not all about going to school, as I said before, and you consider a woman to be an object because you see her like a sex machine, you know, she can steal you for sex, you know, it's all about that. But mm-hmm. we, the women, we need to change our mentality. I'm sorry if I go somewhere, like for my case, sometimes I represent my company in so many places,
mm-hmm.
you know, other company, multinationals sometimes. But I don't need to downgrade myself. Mm-hmm. I go sometimes, I have to meet a customer. I've done a presentation like sleepless nights trying to convince that customer. Or maybe like talking something that is very vital and important. Can you imagine that the customer or the man is mm-hmm. listening, but
he's
looking
hearing.
At my body?
That actually is main
yes,
interest.
Looking at my body, and at the end of the day, you like feel like, no, you know, the presentation was interesting. I think this is a way for, no, you see, can I get your number?
Mm-hmm. Right.
So, you see, it's really a problem because the males, is their mentality. But mm-hmm. as Madam said, We should grow above that. That is what they think.
Mm-hmm.
Let them think. And let's move ahead because we are not at that level. We are above that.
Yeah.
You need to prove to them that you are above that.
Yeah.
I had a colleague that she was 23 years. Everywhere she went to, because she was like a minor.
Mm-hmm.
Can you imagine? Everywhere she went to, sometimes I send her, delegate her, please, can you want to do me this duty in this office? She goes everywhere. I mean, every man she meets wants to have, you know, intercourse with her, you know, you are so beautiful, you are this. But when she came back, she told me, no, you know, this is a situation I'm facing, it's a challenge, but I cannot, you know, succumb to it. I cannot bring myself down to that yeah. level because every man that is not because I'm so beautiful. Yes, mm-hmm. I'm beautiful, but I have to go above that. I cannot sell myself.
Yeah, you're not in a beauty contest.
Yeah.
You've come to work.
You've come to work.
And if you start, you'll never end. You just keep giving in.
Yeah. That is it. And tomorrow, they'll be the first to laugh and to put your name on the magazine.
Exactly.
As you can see, this is how she is. Physically, this is how, inside, this is how she looks like. Because mm-hmm. they feel like more empowered when they say mm-hmm. things, when they downgrade the woman.
Yeah.
So for me, I think that part of sexism is an issue we cannot avoid,
yeah.
but the way we look at it is what matters.
Right.
No matter how they look at it, we have to move ahead.
Right.
I believe one day they will see that, no, I think there's some craziness that they need to take out.
Mm-hmm. Will they? Well, let's hope. Let's hope so. Let's hope it happens someday. I'm very sure.
I just believe that we, like this 21st century moms, mm-hmm. because at this time we cannot change. It's difficult to change a grown man.
Yeah.
But it's easy to you know, grow, to change.
Yeah, to groom,
a baby boy. Mm-hmm. So we are going to be having babies, we're having baby boys, let's teach our children that women are not sex objects. Women can cause that change from the home.
Yeah.
That's the best we can do. Let's educate our boy children. If you educate your son, he will try to educate his friends. And if your son is an example, other people's children will learn from him. Mm-hmm. So I just think that's all we can do at this point, because these grown men, we can try as much as we can, but there's hardly going to be 100% success to change their mentality. Can change them.
Let me add something to that. I think, as you said, it's like transmissional.
Mm-hmm.
The fact that my dad considered my mom
mm-hmm.
like that.
Mm-hmm.
You see, most children, They tend to be like that.
Exactly.
If you see like children nowadays that are suffering from what we call abandonment from the dad, if you notice, they will grow up, they will never see a woman as a woman. They will see her like an object because the dad abandoned him when he was young. The dad abandoned him and the mother was struggling alone, sent him to school, educated him, was always there when he's sick. But the daddy was never interested. But the daddy is only waiting for the moment when the child is grown up, is working in an office. Hey, I'm the dad. No. So you see, it's kind of transmissional because the way you treat your mom, or your wife, the child is looking at it. So the education matters. And tomorrow you see that child will tend to behave the same because the way the dad has treated the mom. So I think if we start out, we as the 21st century woman, tomorrow we'll have to pass the command to others. Yeah. If we start doing it today, I think tomorrow there will be a change because we are impregnating something into the society.
Right.
Right. And a related issue, in Cameroon, in like most of Africa, unfortunately, the woman's value, the woman's respect even, is tied to a man. When you're young, it's your father, and when you're older, it's your husband. So a woman who doesn't have a husband, generally people do not respect in Cameroon. As a Cameroonian woman, how does that make you feel?
I no longer have who can disrespect me? Seriously, like I even talk about it, I'm like, no, that was like the worst time of my life. I mean, I was No. And I'm not going to get married again. I mean, the conventional marriage way. No. Because I don't want to satisfy any expectations by whosoever. As for me, I'm like, if I'm good with you, I'm good with you. We don't need that formalization. Seriously, that is where I am now in my life. And no, it's not 41 that I'm going to start changing my mind. So instead, if I'm making it up now like this, maybe at 70, if I even get there. But that's me. Because I'm like, no, why? As you said, yes, as a child. And that's how we grew up. So we just thought it was okay. That's your covering. This whole idea of somebody to cover you because you cannot stand on your own. Somebody has to cover you. So you are not an equal human being, a full human being. Somebody has to cover you. Because the Bible says so and tradition says so, everything. So after your father finishes to cover you, of course, he hands you over to somebody. That was the normal thing, right? And then this person now takes over from your father and he continues to cover you. Remember even to travel out of Cameroon. I was growing up. I remember Yahweh started in 1980-something. When they abolished that law that you had to take the permission of your husband. Because when you go to the embassy, you had to show the authorization of your husband before they could even receive your file and start to study it, right? It was automatic. When you get married, you have to change your name. What do you mean by you don't want to change your name? So many things. It's like, if you don't have that, then there's something wrong with you. What respect do you want to get from society? You're not married. Who are you, mademoiselle, up to what age? But of course, I'm mademoiselle now. Who dares disrespect me? Seriously, I put you on your place. So I think, yes, it's good sometimes to be stubborn, to say, no, I'm not buying into this thing anymore. And it is not appropriate. It is not helping anybody. Yeah. And a woman was not taken from the soul of a man.
Right.
If you're going to go by that Bible, she was taken by it from the rib. That's by the side.
Right.
So how come from the side you end up being under the soul?
Right.
Something has happened somewhere, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I don't think that we need to continue with that kind of mentality in society. And then those girls who, because we are talking about women, those women or girls who think that it has to end there, and if it doesn't get there, then you are still finding your way around. Well, we have to change that. I think you, the woman, should be able to define what controls you, what bothers you. Those kind of things don't bother me at all.
Right. But it's so frustrating sometimes, Clarice, especially when women are those, or the women make you feel like you are incomplete because you are not partnered yet, because you're not married yet. Your aunties, sometimes even the people who mean the best for you, they come and say, See, you're growing old, you need a man. Mm-hmm. A woman is not complete without a man. Mm-hmm. It can be very frustrating for a woman.
Right.
And it's so wrong too.
Yeah, it's actually frustrating, but you know, it's the way, like, just, you know, it's the way we have, you know, the way we have put it, the way we believe that it has to be. By the end of the day, I believe that everybody should, you know, fix their goals. If you want to get married, if that is a goal you want to achieve the goal. Just like she said, that's not something she wants. Every woman has the liberty to have to, you know, if you don't want to get married, don't get married. If you want to get married, okay, get married, you know. It should not be by force. And unfortunately, with you know, society, I'm glad that things are changing a little bit, but it's still there. Like, people still have that belief that if you're not married, oh, why is she not married? But she's nice, she's working, she has money, why is she not married?
Then she has a problem. Something wrong. If you're not married, wrong. Then you have a problem. Yeah, something is wrong with
something
you.
Something wrong. She should be rude.
You know, unfortunately, that's something that most of us say. Like, I cannot say I've said it myself, you know. It's unconsciously, you say that, you're like, what did I just say? You know, you're like, but this girl, she's beautiful. Now, why's nobody married her, you know? Unconsciously, we
maybe
say
she
it.
She chose not to get married.
Yeah, that's it. So, just like, you know, and then as I've grown older, I've learned more things. That's the language I don't use anymore. At first, I used to say it. I said, but why is she not married now? She's really nice and she's working. Where this auntie, you know? But as I grew older, I understood a lot of things. You know, there are some women that want to get married, but they have not been chanced. There are many things that happen. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's not even about finding the partner. It's about finding the kind of partner you want.
Exactly, setting your standards.
So there are a lot of things involved, you know. And right now, I'm not putting any time, because before, when we were growing up, we used to have this calendar.
Yeah.
You know, when you're 22, I'm married. When I'm 25, I have my first child, all of that. But now, you know, when you grow older, you understand the way life happens, and you're like, you cannot put a calendar on anybody's life.
Yeah.
When you see people, you appreciate them for who they are. You no longer treat the woman differently because she's not married. That makes you, what does that make you?
Yeah.
How can you be treating somebody because of how, you know, attached she is? There are people that are married and they're suffering just because they want to be married.
Yeah.
So at the end of the day, marriage is not an accomplishment. I always say that it's not. It's a goal. If it's a goal you want to attain and you get it, that is your personal achievement. It's not an accomplishment that they'll give you a certificate or they'll, you know. It should not be like that.
Like,
that's not what it is.
Reward for respect.
For respect or for success.
Yes.
It's not. Mm-hmm. Marriage is your personal. It's companionship. It is something. It's your life. It's like. It's not that you have accomplished anything for the society.
Yeah.
You know, the women accomplish things every day. They have degrees, they have jobs, they own businesses. People don't celebrate them for that, but they're waiting for the day that, is she married or is she not married? Why is she not married? You know, we should stop. I think that we should just change that mentality, because it's true that it's the way we grew up, and many of us in Africa have that mentality. I myself, I had that mentality.
Mm-hmm.
But until I grew, you know, older, when I got to the 22, I was thinking I'll get married and I was not married myself. I said, but this thing that I used to look at people and say, now, why is this auntie not married? Why am I not married, you know? So it changed the way I think and everything. And I feel like that's the mentality that people should have. Mm-hmm. You should not judge people based on whether they are married or not. Mm-hmm. That should not be a yardstick for anything.
Yeah.
You know, marriage is not, if someone is married, you celebrate with them. But it should not be a reason why you treat a woman differently or treat her because she's married. That's the problem.
And sometimes some men get to be, they're rude, like outrightly rude sometimes. Mm-hmm. A man says, she's not married, she's everybody's wife.
Yeah.
So nobody respects her, she can't talk to me. She's, you know, she's unmarried, she's a free woman.
Those are the kind of men that
if you're not married, automatically you're a free woman.
Yeah. Those are the kind of men that have very, very low mentalities. I want to check him, maybe his mother never ever got married in her life. So those kind of people that usually make those kind. Me, my problem is that don't judge somebody based on stuff like that. It doesn't make any sense. For you to judge a woman or treat a woman differently because she's not married, does not make any sense. If a woman has not portrayed characteristics for you to call her, if a woman has not, you know, portrayed characteristics for you to call her a prostitute, don't call her a prostitute because she's not married. So how would you judge a woman, you know, being a prostitute because she's not married? Does that make any sense? You know, most of them have unmarried women in their families, their mothers, their sisters, never got married.
Yeah.
So, you know, that I just, I'm people that usually have that mentality are people that grew up with those kind of unmarried people in their homes.
Yeah.
So they just get to have a certain complex and just see every other person like that.
Yeah, and Colette, the crazy thing about all of this is men who are not married are not treated the same. They are not viewed the same as women who are unmarried.
Mm-hmm.
Why the disparity? Why should it even be an issue that we are talking about today? Why is it men are not judged by the same standards that women are judged?
Okay, thank you very much for that question. I think it's very important. I think men are not judged in that same standard as a woman because, first, the resist class that they have put women. You are a woman and, you know, there are certain things that is an obligation for you to do. Or certain things that it's a right for you to have. And if you don't have it, then there is a problem.
Mm.
For instance, you see a man maybe at 70 years, he's not married, it's okay. You know, he's a good man. I'm sure he has met with terrible women. You know, he just needs to have a co-head. But you see a woman just at the age of 30 without married.
Yeah.
You know, they will say, as they say in French, la femme du peuple. Mm-hmm. The woman of the people.
Everybody's wife.
Everybody's wife. That means you are like a prostitute. You know, you are like yourself. You are so free. But for me, marriage is not a passport to become a woman.
Mm-hmm.
You are a woman and, you know, you are being credited for the values you have. Mm-hmm. Marriage is just an added value because there is a team member that has added for you both to accomplish a particular task. Mm-hmm. So if you are not married today, I don't think it's a problem. For instance, I, for one, I don't share that view because if you want to follow that pressure, like in the African society, of like, no, I need to be married, you know, this, you are going to mess around in so many things because you are not going to be real. You are going to do things, you know, because you are being pressured and you're all along, you have potentials in you. You cannot bring them out because you are like, no, I'm not married, you know, I'm limited. What's wrong with me? No, relax.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Relax. It's not a stage or whatever I can say. It's just a way. It's just a system. But it doesn't mean that it's like air you need to breathe to live. No.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's not air.
Yeah.
So God created marriage. You know, it's a good thing. But if it doesn't come, it's not a problem. You mm-hmm. continue.
Yeah.
Why should you kill yourself?
Just choose not to.
You know, some women, they get to get married to, you know, wrong partners that kill their dreams.
The pressure. Mm-hmm.
Kill the vision they have. Yeah. Imagine, you know, I have a sister. She, you know, a nice girl, very intelligent, ambitious. Today, she's finished
mm-hmm.
because she got married to a man, you know, that, I don't know, it's a cake. You know, she dresses well, it's a problem. She does makeup, it's a problem. You know, you say hello to a man on the way, maybe your brother, it's a problem. So at the end of the day, she's like in a box. She's at home, not like this. Very yes, sir. I don't support that.
That was no marriage.
If you want to get married, you should get married to a partner that you both can partner to accomplish a particular vision. But if it's not, sorry, I cannot keep my vision, I cannot keep my dream because I want to be madame. No, mm-hmm. I'm sorry, I don't have any problem. I'm still single, but I'm very comfortable because it's all about the mindset.
Mm-hmm.
If you're comfortable with your mindset and you take it, you know, it's a normal thing. Why should you have that pressure? But when you start listening to moms, daddies, aunties, sister, friends, they start putting you that pressure. No, mm-hmm. don't put yourself under that pressure. It's not necessary.
Mm-hmm.
It's not necessary.
Yeah. And, you know, it seems like at every stage of being a woman, when you're a girl, the issues you have to deal with, you have to do all the cleaning and the cooking in the house because you're the girl, you're why your brothers play football. As a young woman, the society is pressuring you. You have to get married. It's important. When you eventually get married, if you decide to, you have to deal with being a wife.
Mm-hmm.
You have to deal with being not just a wife. A good wife,
mm-hmm.
being a good mother, and being an excellent worker in the office or whatever mm-hmm. it is you're doing. Now, you've had to do all of that. You've had to play wife, mother, and, you know, a worker, a career woman. Was it easy managing all of that? Even though now you still have to manage being a parent and, you know, your career. Is it easy navigating through all of that?
Hmm. Not easy, not easy at all, you know, seriously. Look, check all of them, Michelle Obama, Hillary Clinton, check all of them. There will always be something you will have to stone down on, give mm-hmm. up, or kind of like, like this, like it's like that, seriously. And then, well, right now, the good thing is, honestly, for me, it's a good thing I'm not a wife. Mm-hmm. So there's nobody expecting me to come back home at any time, to cook any food, to go up, to come down. I just do my thing. What I'm focused on now is my career, my children, and myself, of mm-hmm. course, very important. Let me even start. Myself, mm-hmm. my children, my career, mm-hmm. in that order. So that is it. Family, all the other things that come around the area there. Mm-hmm. But relationship, partner, marriage, all they be very far away, not even in my mind. Okay. But just imagine somebody who is, sometimes I look at women who are still married or who are married, and I'm like, ha, there's something that you are going to
give up.
Even when they have high, they're working and stuff, it's not so easy, you know. Yeah, that's why our minds are always, I saw a picture, they say a woman own railway station, the rails are crossing like that all over mm-hmm. the place. Well, that's a man's own, is just straight like yeah. that. Mm-hmm. As she said, if he comes back, he sits there, he watches his TV. You, as you are coming back, even you can even have an accent, you're just thinking, you're already seeing the rice on the fire, the homework, the dish, you multitask.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So women, I don't know the kind of brain we have, and society and everything just enforces that you have to have that kind of brain. Mm-hmm. But fortunately, I have only boys. So there's nothing there like, it's me who has, actually I cook maybe once or twice a month. I love cooking, but just so that, right, like today, there's one who did not go to school because they finished exam and they said they'll come back on Monday. So he's the one who is cooking today. Made the list, he went to the market. I started grooming them from young
yes.
to do those things. Although there's one girl living at home now, she's not there. We everything is the same. Mm-hmm. So they will not grow up expecting their women to be the one to be running mm-hmm. all over the place. For what good reason?
Mm-hmm.
She said it, we have to be able to share, understand.
Mm-hmm.
It's not even something to be discussed. I'm seriously sometimes see shocked people, see arguing whether who should clean the floor today, who should clean yeah. tomorrow, who should
really?
Cook, who should.
Right. 2020,
no. And those boys know if they have a relationship or get married tomorrow. And I even hear the woman complaining, they are making her feel like she's the one to do all of those things. I'll come in there and be, I'll not be difficult mother, I'll not be difficult mother, I embarrass you well and proper.
Yes.
Even now, I embarrass them. You have to be able to do those things and stop putting all of that pressure on the woman to the point where at some point you just give up the career because, well.
Yeah. yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Because most times that's what women drop.
Mm-hmm.
Ah, drop so now you understand why we are good in school and everything, and at some point, you don't see them again.
Mm-hmm.
You are working now. Is it easy now to keep up a relationship? At some point, you'll be like, no, I don't want to sacrifice my career also. That marriage tonight, because you can get married and the thing slows you down.
Mm-hmm.
Or you say, okay, well, let me get married and hope that the man is an understanding one and he mm-hmm. will support me through mm-hmm. it. But then the babies come, whether you like it or not, now the whole thing just destabilizes you. How do you manage all of that?
It's true.
It's not easy. It's not easy mm-hmm. being a 21st century woman
mm-hmm.
and doing all the things that you want to do, not allowing yourself to be limited by society
mm-hmm.
and what we have been told, but you know, going about your own thing, it's yeah. not easy, mm-hmm. but we have to manage it sometimes,
mm-hmm.
like being a parent and being a working woman.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you have to manage it, but like she said, it can never be like 50-50-50 or 100-100-100,
right.
You know. There's one that will go down, because let's say you have your 100% skill, that you can do 100%, so it can never be equal. There'll be one that may be 50, maybe there's going to be, maybe when you have a baby, you go on maternity leave, maybe six months, during that period your career is down, it's your baby you're taking care of,
yeah.
you know, when your baby is big, when you have another one, during that period of career, so it can never be equal. But I think like women, we are blessed with the ability to be able to multitask, we are blessed yeah. with the ability to be able to find balance in life, mm-hmm. you know, find balance between family, career, and everything that we have to do. So in all of this, the only, like, what we need, when it's about bringing, when it comes to, like, the marriage, wife thing,
yeah.
and in all of this, you need somebody who is going to support you. Because yeah. at the end of the day, you cannot be struggling with kids, struggling with career, and they are struggling with husband. Mm-hmm. They are struggling with somebody who does not understand you.
Who is very unsupportive.
You need a supportive husband, gym somebody killer. Who understands your business or your career.
Collect us the dream killer.
Yes, gym killer. Actually, you need somebody who will support your career, support your life. You know, support you and the kids, and know that this is how it is. Okay, if she's coming back at this time, I can help the child. I can do the child's homework. It should not be that I'm helping my wife to do my child's homework. It's your child. It's yeah. our child. So if you do the child, it's not supposed to, the wife is not the only person that's supposed to do that.
Yeah,
you know, so at the end of the day, I think we have the ability to find balance, even though it's not easy, but I think it's very possible to do it. Whatever it is that at every point, whatever it is that you need to let go to, you know, do it. And now letting go does not usually mean that you disappear completely. When Michelle Obama got married to Barack, she sacrificed her career for a while.
Yeah.
She wasn't practicing law. She wasn't doing anything. She was the first lady of the U.S. while Obama was the president. She had to play that role. So it's just about being supportive. It's about finding somebody that you think you can share your life with, and people can understand each other.
Yeah.
And if it's about the kids, about the career, there can always be a balance.
Yeah.
You know. Yeah.
And also it depends on what a person prioritizes. A woman may choose that what I prioritize is being a wife and being a mother.
Mm-hmm.
That's what you want to
do.
You're not being forced by anybody or society.
Society.
That's
yeah.
Your personal choice. If that's your dream, of course that's fine. Nobody is saying don't mm-hmm. do what you want to do.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody is saying career is more important than everything else.
Exactly.
Personally, I think family first.
Yeah.
You know? Mm-hmm. Nobody is saying career is more important than anything, everything else. But mm-hmm. if that's what you want to do, do not be forced to do something you don't want to do. I think that's the point we're
trying
to make.
That's the point we are trying to
make. So people don't get it wrong.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. And your take on the subject, Colette?
I think a woman is supposed to get that balance between the career and the family.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, the fact that you're working, it doesn't make you, you know, to become like, you know, not taking care of your family.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, when you have to balance your career and your family.
Mm-hmm.
So you know you have your work to do and you have your family to take care of.
Mm-hmm.
If you have things you're supposed to do, like taking care of the kids, taking care of the house you're supposed to, but I think a woman can do that because, as we said before, she can multitask.
Mm-hmm.
Many a times I'm in the office, you know, I'm working, you know, on something, sending emails, but my brain, as I'm doing that job in the office, my brain is in the house.
Mm-hmm.
It's my son back from school, mm-hmm. I see eating. So you can imagine, I have like 20 things, ideas in my head I can be able to manage.
Yeah.
So I think a woman can do that perfectly well because she's a woman.
Mm-hmm.
Naturally, we are endowed with those potentials to multitask and to take care of the work life and the
family
life. We just need to be organized and, you know, we do it the right way.
Mm-hmm.
Let's not take
so that one thing doesn't
imbalance.
Mm-hmm.
So that we like work 80%, family 20%. No, mm-hmm. it's wrong. If you do that, then the work is going to have a problem.
Yeah.
Because once the family is having a problem home, yeah. your child is sick.
The ripples are felt everywhere.
You go back home. You mm-hmm. go back home to take care of the child. And maybe you lose the job.
Mm-hmm.
So there need to be that balance.
Yeah, I agree. I agree with you completely.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, we don't have so much time, but there's one thing I really wanted us to talk about. Women in Cameroon have to deal with a lot of violence. Now, and abuse. You run a foundation, Maria, that focuses on helping women that have been battered, have been abused, sometimes raped. It's a problem in Cameroon. Unfortunately, I don't know if it's because it's of social media and we're hearing too many stories nowadays, or it's just that it's increasing.
No, it's social media.
Okay, so it has always been that way.
Yeah, I think that, yeah, it's maybe increasing too because of all the problems too and the stress
exposure
all over the place and people just finding relief in doing all kinds of crazy things like
mm-hmm.
abusing people. But not to cut you short, but I think we women ourselves, if we are abused, fine, but we have to pick up, we have to
yeah.
get up. And if we are not abused, then we have to know what abuse is so we don't even allow it,
yeah.
you know, and we know our world, we know who we are. We have to be stronger than what anybody has put in our heads, especially mm-hmm. society, tradition, culture, religion, all of those things. Well, for me, that works, eh?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I've rebranded myself altogether, right?
Yeah.
So I think that when I talk, I also use my personal experiences mm-hmm. so that people see
yeah.
that you have to do something about it, either to prevent it or to heal from it,
yeah.
you know, and stuff like that.
Let me ask you this question. You mm-hmm. deal with this. What would you tell a woman who is being abused, being mm-hmm. battered, or even sexually abused, raped,
mm-hmm.
and does not know what to do? Where does she go to? What does she do? How does she go about it?
Mm-hmm.
Well, but you have to be able to, first of all, speak up.
Yeah.
People don't even want to talk. You know, women are so, this thing, or maybe the image, you know, they're beating you there in the house and everything, but you don't, or even, out in the fine, oh, mm-hmm. for house, fine.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so who knows that what's going on to you?
Right.
And the more you do that, the more you live in that victim mentality. Mm-hmm. To the point where at some point, you don't even know how to get that help anymore. Nobody even knows how to help you. You've been in that thing for too long.
Mm-hmm. It becomes a normalcy for you.
If you had spoken up, fine. But if you now get to the point where you speak up, then allow yourself to be helped and then do the efforts also to respond to it.
Mm-hmm.
If you tell somebody something, it's not automatic that you should leave
mm-hmm.
your marriage. But sometimes it's already so bad, you just have to leave,
mm-hmm.
you know, or you have to work on it together, counseling. Go home and tell, I told a client one day, go and tell your husband, next time both of you should come. She did not, next time she came alone, what happened? I forgot to tell him, but I knew it's because she was afraid. So how can I help you now if you cannot even gather the courage to tell him that both of you have to go for counseling? You know, some of those things. We have lost our self-esteem. Mm-hmm. We've lost self-worth, self-confidence, everything. God, that who are you?
So speak up. That's where to start from. Speak up. That's and if you need help, particularly Maria Banga will be very glad to help. She's a barrister. We told you that at the start of the program. Mm-hmm. And I've been following you up on social media. And,
oh, really?
Yeah.
And I don't even know. So that means that many people, and many people have also been reaching out to me on that same social media, inbox and stuff. And I don't turn people away, but some people are not willing to work. They want some miracle thing, and then the miracle thing doesn't come. Maybe they. The end of just say, okay, we're now God, you know. So,
and we used to have call-ins. We're going to go back to that on the show in subsequent editions. We are hoping when we go back live, and people still reach out to me and through the phone numbers that we used on the show, and they talk about issues they have. Recently, I got a call from someone who needed help with a rape problem. It concerns a kid. So, I'm just saying, if you're watching and you have an issue, here is someone you can contact. Go to Facebook. Her name is Maria Abanga. She also has an account for her foundation, Hope for the Abuse, for the Battered and Abused. So feel free to reach out to her. And like she said, she'll be very glad to respond to you. Now to you, Clarice, very quickly. You only have like a second before the show ends. Thank you so much for coming. Your final words.
My final words for everybody watching is that if you're a woman, believe in yourself, know your worth, develop your skills, express your skills, express your gifts, you know, just live your full potential. If you're a man, don't limit any woman in your life, whether your mother, your daughter, your wife, you know, support them in whatever dream they want to achieve. And, you know, let's just live as good humans, you know, let's just be one another's keeper.
Yeah,
that's it.
And you can also reach out to Clarice on Facebook. Her name is Clarice Ndinge. She also runs a blog. It's called Better Things, right?
Yeah.
She has a talk show. If you've not watched it, then you should. Go to YouTube. It's Better Topo. She's the host. So she knows exactly what she's doing here. Please reach out to her. You also work with girls.
Yeah,
you also work with girls a lot and help girls who have issues. So please feel free to reach out to her. Follow her on Facebook, on Instagram, and chat with her. And Colette, whom I was meeting the second time, but the first time on the show.
Yeah.
It was also great to have you. Final words.
Thank you very much. I think on a final note, I would like to say that as a 21st century woman, we need to believe in ourselves. We need to work hard.
Yeah.
And we need to, you know, go above the fact that the sky is our limit. You can become anybody in life.
Yeah.
And we need to partner with the right people.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. Thank you.
And you can be reached on social media too.
Yes, you can reach me on social media. Tembe Colette.
Great. Feel free to leave a comment, ask a question, anything you have to say on the show, just go to Facebook and type The Diary. You have access to our page on social media. And quick one before we go, please stay safe. Yes, the ministry or the Minister of Health of Public Health has confirmed that it's actually a case of coronavirus in Cameroon. Please stay safe. Wash your hands with soap and running water. Cook your food stuff very well before you eat them. Avoid touching your eyes, your nose, and your mouth. We don't want people to get sick. We can beat it, okay? Stay safe. Bye-bye. We'll see you next week. Mm-hmm.